Hello everyone. Today I'm going to talk about one of my favorite theorems in linear algebra. Not only because it is important, but the proof of this theorem is so fascinating and beautiful. This theorem is called the Gershgorin theorem. Before we dive in, here is something you might want to know to help you understand this video better.Let's first see the definition of Gershgorin disks. Here it is. Let's pick a random complex matrix. Pick one row, let's say the first row. We can draw a circle on the complex plane, centered at the diagonal entry, which is the first element in this case, with radius being the sum of the moduli of other elements. We will call this circle.The first Gershgorin disk. Same thing for the second one. Use the diagonal entry as the center, the sum of the moduli of other elements as radius. This is the second Gershgorin disk. And the same thing for the third one. Also, we call the union of all Gershgorin disks the G of A. That's all for the definition of the Gershgorin disk. Now is the fun part. If we calculate the eigenvalues of this matrix and put them in the complex plane, interesting.The eigenvalues are all inside this Gershgorin disk. Could it be the coincidence? Let's try another random matrix. Here is another random matrix that has three disjoint Gershgorin disks. Let's put the eigenvalues in. Interesting, they are still there. Let's try another one.And put the eigenvalues in. Still there. So how about we let the matrix change continuously and see if we can find anything new. Here the circles are the Gershgorin disk and the blue dots are the eigenvalues. Personally speaking, I think this is amazing. It's like the eigenvalues are confined in these areas. What's more, we can observe that if there's one disjoint Gershgorin disk, then there is exactly one eigenvalue in there. If there's two disks intersect with each other, then there are exactly two eigenvalues in that area. If there are three disks, then there are exactly three eigenvalues in that area.Actually, what we found just now is exactly what Gershgorin found in 1931. The formal description is like this. For all n by n matrix A, the spectrum of A, that means all the eigenvalues, is contained in G of A. Further, if there's a connected component of G of A with k disks, then there contain exactly k eigenvalues.The proof of the first part is a little bit dry, so I will put that at the end of the video. Now let's assume we already know the first part. I want to talk about the second part of the theorem. The following proof is completely not rigorous. Actually, it's not even a proof, but it gives us a fantastic picture about how geometry helps mathematicians solve the problem. Okay, here's our matrix.Now let's decompose this matrix into two parts. The first part contains the diagonal entries. Let's call it D. The second part contains the other entries. Let's call it N. Now I want to define another matrix A epsilon like this. It has a variable epsilon. So if epsilon equals 0, then A epsilon is just the diagonal part of matrix A. so it's equal to D. If epsilon equals 1, then A epsilon is the whole matrix A again. Now, starting from epsilon equals 0, I want to slowly increase epsilon to 1 and keep track of A epsilon. That means our matrix A epsilon will change, starting from matrix D and ending with matrix A again. Also, this change is somehow continuous. Let's look what's gonna happen here. When epsilon equals 0, A epsilon is the diagonal matrix, so the eigenvalues equal to the center of the Gershgorin disk, which are all just a dot in the graph. When epsilon is a small number, the center do not change, but the radius of each Gershgorin disk is growing, so our Gershgorin disk is getting larger. But from the first part of the theorem, even the eigenvalues are moving, we know they are still inside of each disk. Also, because our change of A epsilon is somehow continuous, there is no way that an eigenvalue can jump into the unconnected area. So each disk contains exactly one eigenvalue. At the time two Gershgorin disks intersect, they form a connected component. Two disks are connected now, but the number of eigenvalues are still 1 plus 1 equals 2. When epsilon grows to 1, we have our matrix A back, and the same things hold true. So, a connected component of G of A with k disks must contain exactly k eigenvalues. Let's see another example. This time, we will focus on the movement of the eigenvalues. Okay, now we know where the eigenvalues are. We can get some useful information just from the graph. Here's the proposition. If the centers of all the Gershgorin disks are too large, then this matrix is invertible. What do I mean? Here's an example. You know, if a matrix is not invertible or singular, then it must have 0 as an eigenvalue. By the Gershgorin theorems, that means at least one Gershgorin disk has to contain the origin. But hey, here all the radius cannot reach that far. That means this matrix does not have 0 as an eigenvalue, so this matrix is invertible. How neat the proof is that? By the way, this kind of matrix is called a strictly diagonally dominant matrix, which have the modulus of radius smaller than the modulus of the center. Let's say another fun fact. If a matrix is almost strictly diagonally dominant, except one row, and this row is diagonally dominant, then it is still invertible. Look at this graph. Disk 1 and disk 2 are strictly diagonally dominant. They do not contain the origin. And disk 3 barely contains the origin. It goes through the origin. I claim that the 0 still cannot be the eigenvalue. This matrix is still invertible. Let's prove it from the graph. You can see that this matrix is almost strictly diagonally dominant. If we can shrink disk 3 just a little bit, then it is strictly diagonally dominant. And by the last proposition, we know it means invertible. Now, I want to do a similarity transformation like this. Note that after the multiplication, the matrix is similar to the original one, and the similar matrix have the same eigenvalues. Now let's look what this multiplication does. For disk 1 and disk 2, their radius are increased by a little. And for disk 3, the radius is shrunk by a small ratio. So as long as we make sure epsilon is a small number, our matrix is strictly diagonally dominant, and that completes the proof. Okay, here's the first part proof I promised to you guys. I hope you enjoyed this video. Until next time.